This video has been made possible by Paradox Interactive. Join the official Stellaris Discord server using the link in the description below. Fallen Empires are the source of ambition within Stellaris, the promise of power, being able to grow from a fledgling small species in a backwater part of the galaxy to their level is something that drives a player forward. However, they've always been in an envious position, being able to muster the power of the Titan Lance and being able to carve out a hole in your fleet with surgical precision using their Titan-class ships. This is now a thing of the past, as Apocalypse introduces an array of ships that makes the Fallen Empires finally meet their match. Today we're going to be taking a look at these ship classes that are available to you. The Titan, the Ion Cannon, and finally, the almighty Colossus. Let's start off with the Titan and then we'll work our way forward. First of all, Titans. What do I do? Well, first of all, they have the ultimate weapon in the game. The Perdition Beam. The Perdition Beam is by far the strongest beam-based weapon in the game. It is an energy weapon. It does somewhere between 5,000 and 10,000 damage. This is more than enough to blast anything out of the sky. Now, Titans by themselves have 7 weapon slots. Only one of them is the Titan Lance, and the other 6 are large guns. You can put kinetic artillery on these or neutron torpedoes, whatever you like. Personally, I am very, very happy to slap some neutron torpedoes on there. In addition, though, the Perdition Beam itself has a major advantage, and that is its range. Whenever an enemy fleet is within system, the Perdition Beam will automatically lock on and start firing. This means that you will have a massive advantage over anybody who does not have a Titan within their fleet. Range is everything, and being able to engage the enemy at a distance means that you can kill them before they can get to you. That right there is something you want to keep in mind, but this is not the biggest strength of the Titan. No, the biggest strength of the Titan is actually not so much as a attack chariot, it is a support vessel. Why a support vessel? Well, it has these aura effects, and aura effects are separate modules that you can install on your Titan. There are 6 of them. There's a quantum destabilizer that reduces enemy fire rate by 10%, the shield dampener, which reduces enemy shield by 20%, the subspace snare, which reduces the combat disengagement of the enemy by 20%, and also reduces their emergency FTL cooldown, which is a great way of annihilating an enemy fleet that cannot jump out. And in addition to these, there is also some positive bonus that you can add to your own fleet. Inspiring Presence, which increases fire rate by 5%, the Nanobot Cloud, which improves regeneration on all of your fleet ships, and of course, the Targeting Grid, which increases the tracking bonus on all your ships by 10%. And especially if you're engaging a fleet consisting of a lot of small ships, having more tracking on your ships is incredibly useful. Now, the major drawback here is that you can only have one aura effect being attached to one Titan at once. This does not mean, however, that you can't have multiple Titans within a fleet applying multiple bonuses. Let's say that you have a Titan that uses the quantum destabilizer to reduce ship fire rate on the enemy side, while at the same time having a second Titan that improves the fire rate for your fleet. It's a case of mixing and matching and being able to deploy the right mixture of aura effects on your doom stack of choice. Of course, the more ships you have in your fleet, the higher the bonus will be, as well, the higher fleet power you have, the higher the percentage application will be. Now, in order to build a Titan, you will need the battleships technology as well as a citadel outfitted with 8 Titan assembly yards, and this can only be done at maxed out space stations that also happen to have shipyards on them. So be careful with fitting out your stations, as you will need this special fleet yard in order to build them. And they are not exactly cheap either. They do cost over 2,500 alloys, so be careful with them. Make sure that you engage the enemy at your discretion. Then there is the Ion Cannon. Now, the Ion Cannon is very similar to the Titan, except it doesn't have any engines on it, and it is part of your defense superstructure. Usually, you can only have about 2 or 3 of these attached to your stations, and of course, as before, they need to be in a citadel layout in order to be able to build them. However, once you have access to these, they are a great way to defend your space from the enemy. Put them over in a choke node, expecting the enemy that come to you and blast them to pieces before they can even get within combat range. Now, they are stationary. They will engage from across the system and have a base cost of 2,000 alloys. So make sure that you have got the economy to back up this build. Finally, there is the gun, pointed at the heart of the galaxy. The largest, most powerful weapon that you can have. However, it doesn't really work on ships. It is, in fact, a Colossus. The Colossus is a very special type of ship. Then it can only engage planets. That's right, this is a planet killer, and it can apply all sorts of terrible things upon these planets. Whilst you may be familiar with its planet cracker design, this is not necessarily the only way of using a Colossus. The Colossus beam is actually subdivided into several categories, five of them actually. There's, of course, like I mentioned, the planet cracker, which destroys planets, and if you destroy a habitable world, you will get some space minerals for your troubles. And if you're a pacifist, you cannot build it. Then there is, of course, the neutron sweep. What does the neutron sweep do? Well, all it does is apply neutron radiation, whatever that is, onto a planet and destroys every single pop on a planet, leaving all of the infrastructure intact, ready for your colonists to come down and start using them. They will, however, have to deal with a little bit of a reduced habitability bonus on a planet for a couple of years, but after that, it is just smooth sailing. Then there's the global pacifier. The global pacifier basically creates a giant, impenetrable force field around a planet that basically locks them in there forever. That's horrible. But yeah, at least you get a planet that generates 10 society research, and considering society research in space is rather rare, this may be something for you to do. Of course, this is one that is available to pacifists, so not only do pacifists have not access to the planet cracker or neutron sweep, no, they can have access to something much worse, the global pacifier. Then there is the divine enforcer. Every single pop on a planet will become spiritualist, and over a period of several years, there will be a 999% modification to ethics towards spiritualism on a planet. It will kill every single robot, a synthetic, or hive minds on that planet. Now, this is for spiritualists only, and only if you've already unlocked telepathy. So for those of you who like to embrace the shroud, this is probably a good way of dealing with things. And finally, there is the nanobot diffuser. The nanobot diffuser is unique, as in it is only accessible to the driven assimilator subtype of machine empires. No longer will you have to go through an audacious process to assimilate every man, woman, and child. No, we just release the nanobots and let them do their work and assimilate every single man, woman, and child on that planet below. Of course, as long as they're not robots or hive minds. So yeah, that's something to look forward to. As I mentioned, synthetic dawn only. Now, it is important to note that every single use of a Colossus will cause significant upheaval within the galaxy. Nobody will be happy with you using it unless, of course, it's on an empty world, you know, for testing purposes. You can always test your planet buster on an empty world and to get to those delicious minerals on the inside, but as soon as you use it on something habitable, people will be annoyed. Also, if you use it on a holy world, holy guardians will instantly wake up and they will not be happy with what you have just done. Now, in order to get access to the Colossus, you will need the Titan's technology, a ascension perk, which is the Colossus project, which then kicks off a seeker project, and then halfway through said project, you can pick your weapon type, at least the one that applies to your ethic, and from there on, you can just go ahead and research whatever remaining weapon that you want, as long as, of course, it fits within your ethics range. Now, it's also important to know that Fallen Empires have been upgraded in Apocalypse, and they have a chance of having these planet killers as part of their arsenal. It's 10%, actually. But yeah, as soon as they wake up, they can just build them whenever they want. I want to thank Paradox Interactive for making this video possible. If you haven't done already, head over towards the Stellaris Discord server. There is a link down in the description below, as well as in the pinned comment. and go ahead and hang out. And if you've got any questions about the game and I am not around, feel free to drop it in there, because there is a lot of people there already that are happy to listen to your stories about Stellaris, as well as any questions that you may have. Thank you also to my patrons as well, and we're gonna go and wrap up this video here. If you thought this was informative or you liked it in general, then feel free to give it a like and or subscribe. But until next time, take good care of yourselves, and as always, eat shutter.